for the afternoon. I'm ready to introduce our next speaker, which is Marc Schwager from Vector Informatik GmbH. Marc Schwager studied computer science at the Technical University of Braunschweig. After 4 years in the KANU canalizer development, he worked as a project engineer at Vector Cantech in the USA for 3 years. Since 2012, he's a product manager in the area of KANU canalizer, where amongst other things, he's responsible for the KANU option AMD XCP and CANopen. And the topic of his presentation is a new approach for simulating and testing of CANopen devices. Marc, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much, Uwe. Thank you for the introduction. Thanks a lot for the opportunity to be here in the first virtual conference. Today, I would like to talk about simulation and testing of CANopen devices. So from the physical layer, we just saw quite a few steps up on the application layer CANopen, and how a new approach, how we can test it here, and what new things can we learn, or what we learned in the past. So here in my presentation, let's see if the slide works. Yeah, fine. I would like to do some introduction on the topics I'm working on, and especially now when it comes to CANopen. I will give you a very short overview about the artifacts that we need here and what we are working on. Then I would like to talk about the different approaches when it comes to testing CANopen devices. I'm very happy that we have another session about the CANopen conformance testing, or CANFP CANopen testing, coming up after my presentation. That would be a very nice complement to this session, I guess. And then I would present an idea about how to simulate CANopen devices very easily with the artifacts that you typically have and that the standard provides. And I would like to go over test automation capabilities and show here how we make use of the simulation for a nice test framework. And then I will give a short summary, and I'm open for discussion. So let's start. From our point of view, and of course, CANopen is a very mature technology today, and standardized by the CIA, it's used really in various industries and quite a lot. There are so many applications out there. And one of the reasons is really the flexibility and interoperability of CANopen devices. And so this is a very well documented standard. And so we have a very defined interface where how we can access these devices that are out there. And we see the application area ranges really from trains to medical. We see lift applications. We have automotive applications, like these specialty cars for the police or fire trucks. I mentioned medical and engineering and multiple more. So my focus today is how can we assure the functionality of a new software release of such a device in all its usage scenarios? So especially if it's not a complete machine like we see here, it might be just a subsystem or a subcomponent. How can we make sure that if I make some changes to the new software inside this device, that it still complies here and works well in a large CANopen environment that I may not even know, because due to the nature of the standard, can be integrated in other machines from other vendors and so on. And so this is a very interesting and challenging task. Now, just let us take a very short look on some of the CanOpen artifacts that I will use. So each CanOpen device has an object dictionary. This, in the end, is a collection of parameters, if you will, and they are used for configuration of the device as well as process data. Process data meaning this is the actual data that the device creates or uses. The standard demands that they are accessible via an index and subindex, and the CIA defined ranges for which purpose those parameters are used. So for example, the 1000 range is used to configure a device. The 2000 range is used for manufacturer-specific objects, and then the 6000 range is usually defined by the application profile that is again open standard. So for example, if you have a motor or an I/O device, then the standard tells you which elements are located here at which address. For this object dictionary, or for each device that complies to CanOpen and has an object dictionary, there's an electronic data sheet. This is basically a file that is machine readable, and it contains the object dictionary with its default values. So if you use this out of the box, then it tells you, okay, this is how the machine will start up. This is how the device behaves. And we see here, there are two formats actually. There's an older but nicely readable Windows INI file style. So you see here, there's a clear name for the object 1000. And we also see data type and default value here. Then derived from the electronic data sheet, there's a device configuration file, or you can actually create this. And it stores the current configuration of a device. So if I program a device in a way where, for example, modify one of those parameters and tell the device to store it, then the device will boot up next time with exactly that configuration. So most of the time, this file type, the device configuration type, is simply derived from the EDS file by a configuration tool. So you open the standard database, you set up the devices, and in order to store it for the next time you configure a network, then you can save it in the DCF, the device configuration file. And again, this is a standard file format, so it's defined in the specifications of CanOpen. Now, let's talk a little bit about testing these CanOpen devices. First of all, and this will be also part of the next session, the CIA provides a so-called CanOpen conformance tool. Here I brought a picture, in essence, checks the, it just needs an electronic data sheet of the device under test. So if I want to test the CanOpen conformance of a device, I need one of those database files I just mentioned, EDS. I load it here, and then the CanOpen conformance test will basically tell me if the device complies to that database, and it will run some tests based on what the content is of the EDS file. So for example, it ensures the conformance to the network management, or if it's handling the SDO protocol well, and if it's testing the, well, if it contains process data objects, we can do a mapping test, for example, test this out, or the emergency functionality. So all these artifacts or the things that are defined in the CanOpen standard, they are tested here. And the trick now is this is completely independent from the functionality of the device. So I've read in the next presentation, it's called the lower layer test, if you will. And the upper layer is what I will be talking about today, is really the application test that sits, or test the application that sits on top of a GenOpen stack. So this is a very nice way to assure that your device is GenOpen compliant. But again, it's not a full application test at that end. And the tool is also not extensible, so it provides exactly that. It runs the conformance test spec, basically. So back to the question from my beginning, how can we actually test the application then of a GenOpen device? So first of all, one idea is we can do a manual test. Yeah. So for example, if it's an IO sensor, let's say a temperature sensor, then what we can do is we might be able to heat it up and then check the messages that are coming out and see if it works well or not. The other way around, if it's a motor, we could actually somehow stimulate the proper GenOpen messages and then verify the reaction. So for example, check if the motor starts turning, if I send the right PTOs to the motor. What I typically see, and this is when I've created this presentation, it reminded me of my time in the US. Actually, this is pretty common when it comes to testing GEN devices in general. During my time, I remember reading through a 50 pages Word document and then performing some manual tests and documenting the results also in Word or Excel. Typical problems with that. First of all, reading through a Word document is everyone interprets sometimes it very differently, especially when you're not the native, or in most cases, not even the author of the document at this or was speaking the language natively. So there are some problems, but also you simply might be overlooking stuff. And so in the end, it takes forever. Reading through these Word documents every time, you get a little faster, but in the end of the day, it takes really long time, and then you have to manually somehow perform these tests, stimulate the right messages. In general, this really takes a long time. In combination with that, or as an idea, I could use other real existing GenOpen devices, so it doesn't have to be a GEN tool, also other GenOpen devices that I simply connect to my device under test and somehow make sure that it still works as expected. I think this is a very good idea. Nowadays, where we are all in home office, then availability all of a sudden becomes a problem. Where's my test device? I don't know. It was in the office or somebody borrowed it and I cannot go there. And also cost. If I have to buy any device that may be connected to my device under test, then I need to buy quite a lot of other devices. And so that is probably not a good solution. And also the question, how do we automate those tests? If I have a completely working device, I probably still have to somehow operate it manually. So, and this is the idea of this presentation. Now, what would happen if we actually simulated these other devices, and how can we do this? So, in order to, or as a nice, or as an intro, an introduction here, how do I actually set up GenOpen devices? Typically, I need to somehow configure a working GenOpen network. And I mentioned this in the beginning, there might be a configuration tool, but when I introduced the DCF format, you realized it's really a device configuration file. So that means it's a decentralized approach. Each device knows its configuration, but it does not know anything about the counterparts. So in order to set up my test system, I first of all have to decide an example configuration or somehow configure it. So in essence, when you set something up, then we need to consistently edit these files so that it fits together. That means I will have maybe a simulated device that sends something, and I have my system under test. I have to configure it that it receives what the simulation sends, and vice versa, obviously. And when you do something like this, this is actually the first test already, because you can see if the configuration that you have in the device, if this is consistent to what you have in your test system set up. Here, I just have as an example how you could visualize this. Here, what we see is the heartbeat configuration. The heartbeat configuration of each device is actually stored in a few of those objects, the 1016 and 1017 objects from the object dictionary that I showed in the beginning. Here, we see that some devices are configured to produce a heartbeat, and then I can see how the consumers are configured, and every device can consume any producer that it wants. And here I can already check if there's a misconfiguration or if I still have to tweak it. Here we see, for example, the producer produce every 500 milliseconds a heartbeat. So that means the device is available and online. And then if the consumer assumes a lower rate, so like 400, then it will go into an error and will not behave properly. Yeah. So by setting this up with a configuration tool, this is the first step to actually have a valid configuration that I can operate my system under test in. Now, let's take a look into stimulation. So here we have a graphical representation of one of those CAN buses. It pretty looks like the architecture diagrams we've seen before. So I may have some devices here. One might be the one under test. And now the idea is I could actually use the device configuration files from the configuration I just set up in order to create here a CANopen stack simulation as a counterpart simulation for my system under test, actually. Yeah. Because this is a valid configuration, and if every of those virtual CANopen devices behaves exactly like configured in the DCF files, then I have my test environment here set up. With the idea that, or what I mean by a stack simulation is that those simulated ECUs here or devices behave exactly like real CANopen devices. So if you're not familiar with the standard, you know, for example, when you boot a device up, it sends out a message, the so-called boot up message, and then you realize, okay, it's there, and the device under test might take this and perform some actions, or for example, start the heartbeat recognition and so on and so forth. So this is really important that you have the full CANopen stack here running. And when we do this in a simulation environment, we can basically simulate a lot of instances of CANopen devices and act as if they were real CANopen devices that I just connected. A little different representation of what I just showed. So in our simulated network, what we could automatically do is we could automatically instantiate a CANopen stack here with these components. So for example, the network management control, the service data object control, and also the process data objects according to what's configured in these DCF files. So this is what we already know and what the standard gives us. And like in a real ECU, you have to put something on top. Yeah. And so we could use or put here some application code that actually provides some real functionality inside my simulated network in order to test my device under test, the real node that sits outside my tool. Yeah. And yeah, there are multiple ways to do this. So we could, I don't know, write some C code, for example, or maybe even some modeling. Maybe if I have here a MATLAB Simulink model or something like this, it could actually provide the scenario, the environment simulation that I need to get my my node here tested. The second part of the idea is, now that we have these simulated CANopen devices, how do we actually access the object dictionary of them? Because in order to somehow exchange data with my system under test, it would be really helpful if I can somehow put some life in those simulated ECUs or devices, I should say. And so we have to access the object dictionary. The idea is we could do this in as a variable. Yeah. So all these simulated CANopen devices, they just create variables. But this has a problem. So for example, if I have two times the same sensor, for example, I have two temperature sensors, in simulated, then they will contain the same objects in the object dictionary because it's just another instance. So somehow I have to avoid naming collisions. And not only because of the instances, but also because every device that complies to the CANopen standard has certain objects, yeah, like the 1000 object that's always there. So somehow we have to deal with the naming collision, with naming collisions. And an obvious idea could be that we have a hierarchical namespace concept for these variables. Yeah. So for example, we could use somehow an identifier for the CAN network if we have multiple. We know in modern applications for CANopen, you have quite a few, or you may have quite a few CANopen networks. Then we could use an identifier, like the node identifier, and then somehow create an object identifier that really identifies me, the object in the object dictionary. So how would that look like? Well, maybe like this. So my first CAN channel, then node 10, yeah, this is the node ID here, could be. And then the index, so 6064 and subindex 0. Yeah. That would work. And I think as long as I'm really familiar with setting this up, I still remember what node 10 is and what the object 6064 was. Yeah. But I think as soon as I leave the setup or work on a different setup, then I probably already forgot this or which object this addresses here. So let's look at the pro things. It's collision free. So exactly what we wanted is true here. So if I have another node, it will have another node ID. So like node 11. This will not conflict because I have a different namespace. Object dictionary entries, they are also collision free, obviously. So you cannot have two with the same index or subindex. So that works. And what's also on the pro side, this name here would really include CANopen specific details. I already said this. Here's the node ID. Here's the index and subindex of the object entry. Yeah, would be a solution. Now let's look at the con side. Like I mentioned it in the beginning, that would be really cryptic, isn't it? So I don't think I would remember what this actually did, and that it was in a motor and this was the target position. So I think this is very, very hard to deal with. And then what actually happens if I reconfigure my system, might be for a different overall test or a different overall setup, or what happens if during the development of the device here, the index was shifted to something else, then I would really have to adapt all my test code where I put in this notation. Yeah. And I think this will be almost impossible to get it right and also to find errors. So if this, for example, is not the expected object, yeah. So for example, you were thinking, oh, I have to access the 65. I don't think you will find it very soon when you debug your test setup. So what is an option, or how could we do this? We could use here the human readable values. So we learn from the EDS file that the 6064 is actually position actual value. So it's a model, and we could use symbolic names for the device itself. And so this is something I could really easily read here. So let's take a look on how we can use this in test automation. So in general, the first important step is for test automation, we have to script it to fully control CANopen devices that we want to use for testing simply because this is then deterministic. So it's not me reading this test spec over and over again and making some mistakes. And so here it's very, very clear and very reproducible. The advantage is also this will set my system under test in a very defined test environment, because the nodes will, or the simulated CANopen devices will provide exactly that environment where the device under test will run in. And in order to set something up, it should be very easy to write these programs, and most important to read it, because when I come back in a few weeks and want to modify something, I have to understand the code. And even worse, if my colleague was writing the code, the chances are very minimal I understand it if we would keep this syntax we've seen before with the index and subindex in there. And so as an example, what you could do is we could use a programming language that is somehow communication oriented to what we have in on the standard. And so for example, here I have this clear names derived from the DCF file in the end. I clearly see that here my test code is accessing an object in the object dictionary of my node, and this value is called delta time. So this is really human readable. And again, this value of the object dictionary here was exchanged with my device under test, or would be from the device under test. And then I can probe. Another way for someone who doesn't like programming languages too much, we could also think about a table-oriented design, where simply somehow enter just the names of these variables and then use it here and to set something up. And what's also important for a test system, it should serve really all interfaces of the device under test. So here, as a graphical example, what we've just seen was a small fraction probably of the test. So we will stimulate the CANopen communication here over the network, but usually it also has other inputs and outputs where I need other measurement hardware for. And that is as easy as supply voltage or any type of IO, serial communication, and so on. And for these concepts, it would also fit if we map, for example, analog IO pins here also in our variable concept. And for example, to turn on the value, the voltage, our test script could be extended to something like this. So with this, I'm right on time at the end of my presentation here. Just things to take away. I think, automated testing can save a lot of time and definitely increase the product quality a lot. We went over two aspects of this testing. Yeah, we looked at the CANopen conformance test that is available from the CIA and had a look here on how you could actually do an application test on top of this. I showed how such a test system could be purely based on device configuration files when you start this, and how easy this would be if you have access by a nice variable concept to access the object dictionary from test scripts. And with these test scripts, you could also automate the other input and output and other test hardware. With that, I would like to thank you very much for your attention.